Thank you, Helen Jane. It's a beautiful music. We appreciate that. Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I welcome all of you to St. Matthew's, and I see several new faces. If you're new here today, you're especially welcomed here. And we do have a children's church right after a children's message. You can send them along there, or if they wish to stay with you, that's fine. And also, we do have a coffee hour. So I invite you all to the coffee hour to get to know each other. And my welcome extends to those of you who join us virtually today. So it is Lord's Day. Let us rejoice in it. Shall we all stand, if you're able, please, for the call to worship. As the deer longs for flowing streams, my soul is thirsting for God, the living God.
When shall I come and behold the face of God?
Why are you cast, O my soul, and why are you disquieted within me? Remain standing for opening hymn.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I hear the cross of sweetest grace, but holy thee, Jesus' name. Oh, Christ the solid rock is dead.
Loving God, open our ears to hear your word and draw us closer to you, that the whole world may be one with you, as you are one with us in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
To our joys and concerns. Tom Eisinger found his neighbor John incoherent in his yard and called 911. John had suffered a heart attack and needs our prayers, so if you could please keep John in your prayers. So the Archer Davies family thanks the entire St. Matthew's United Methodist Church for your support and assistance during our bereavement and funeral for Sam. God bless you all from Jemina Archer Davies. Thank you. That's it. Thank you.
And I do have a special joy to share with you. So today they're celebrating their 25th wedding anniversary between Chiniere and Incerta Emerua. May I invite them to stand? Please turn around and show your face. Congratulations. And they're the host for Coffee Hour today. So after the service, please make sure that you stop by and enjoy and celebrate with them. All right, with all this joy and concern in our heart, shall we bow our heads and pray? Compassionate God, we like to think that all we have to do is be religious, to speak the words, but that we really don't have to walk the walk. We can get so caught up in rituals and rules that we forget the essence of your word for us. We forget that we are called to truly be people of peace, not just to speak the words, but to practice lives of compassion and hope. So many times in this world, we are challenged to take sides, one against the other, but that is contrary to your will. You call us to stand for mercy, justice, love, forgiveness, hope, and peace. You want us to be people who care deeply about others and about this world. So help us to be ready to truly and joyfully serve you. O God, free us from selfishness and self-centeredness. Lift us to lives of peace. For we offer this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, and people of God say, Amen. Amen. And shall we pray the prayer for Labor Day together, that's on the wall? O God, you have bound us together in this life. Give us grace to understand how our lives depend on the courage, the industry, the honesty, and the integrity of all who labor. May we be mindful of their needs, grateful for their faithfulness, and faithful in our responsibilities to them. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you all stand the hymn before scripture if you are able?
Thank you.
Please be seated.
Today's epistle reading is from the letter of James. Every generous act of giving, with every perfect gift, is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purpose, he gave birth to us by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. You must understand this, my beloved brothers and sisters. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for human anger does not produce God's righteousness. Therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your souls. But be doers of the word and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in the mirror. For they look at themselves and, on going away, immediately forget what they were like. But those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. If any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. The word of the Lord. Please stand as you are able for the gospel acclamation and remain standing for the reading of the gospel. Now when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around him, they noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands, those observing the tradition of the elders. And they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash. And there are also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups and pots and bronze kettles and beds. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" He said to them, "Isaiah prophesies rightly about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'Those people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines.' You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition." Then he called the crowd again and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile. For it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come: sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, debauchery, envy, slander, pride, folly. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Could I have the children join me up front, please? Good morning. Good morning, how are you doing? So, can you tell me what I have here? And what's in it?
Air.
You can feel it, can't you? Want to feel it? Can you feel the air inside? So, which is why when I point this ball at someone, you can feel the air, right, coming out. The reason you feel air coming out of the bottle is because that's what the bottle's filled with. Now, what's in this bottle?
Water.
And what do you think would happen if I took the lid off and squeezed it towards you?
I might get a little wet.
Yeah. Does everybody believes that, right? You would get wet.
I don't want to get wet.
When I just showed you, it's a lot like what the Pharisees and Jesus are talking about in today's scripture. They're talking about this idea that whatever fills you is what comes out. The story starts with the Pharisees, who are religious leaders in Jesus' time. They're scolding Jesus because his disciples ate uncleaned food, well, with unclean hands. And they're concerned that if people eat unwashed food with unwashed hands, that then they will be evil, that unkind things will come out of them, right? But Jesus tells the Pharisees that eating clean food or unclean food does not stop people from doing the unclean things they do, like lying, stealing, and cheating. Things we eat cannot make us sinful, but the things we do or think is what makes us sinful. Jesus tried to tell them that the attitudes of our hearts are more important than the words that we say or the rules that we have. It might seem silly us to so worked up over washing or not washing our food or hands. We can easily become distracted by things that aren't important. For instance, in church, you might be distracted by how people dress to come to church, right? Or maybe what we're having to drink during coffee hour. You might be thinking about that. Yeah. But we have to focus on the details that are really important. And that is, we recognize that we come to church to worship, to put our hearts and minds on Jesus, that he is the center of our faith. It's not what people are wearing or what we're going to drink later on, right? By filling our hearts and minds with God's Spirit and love, it helps our hearts be loving and our minds be just towards ourselves and others. When our hearts are filled up with the overflowing of God's Holy Spirit, there's no room in us for lying or stealing or cheating. When we're overflowing with God's perfect love, we have that perfect love to share with others. Just like the bottle of water, the water comes out of the bottle when it's squeezed, right? Which is also what happens when we fill our hearts and our minds with God, then what comes out of us is God, right? In his way. One of the results of following Jesus and doing what he taught is that we are filled with God's love, which is then what we'll share with others. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for Jesus, who teaches us how to fill up our hearts with your love and then share your love with others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So if you would like to go to children's church, you can follow Ms. Cisrita.
Thank you.
make an announcement. For those of you who have a Toyota Avalon with a tag number 2DP8563, the flash is on. So you may want to check out if you have a on this car. Otherwise, we have to jump you when you leave the church. And shall we bow our heads and pray? Let the word of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. In our journey of faith, the pursuit of holiness is central. Holiness is often associated with a purity, devotion, and separation from sin. However, the question that challenges us today is, what is true holiness? Is it merely about following religious rituals, or is it something deeper, rooted in the very core of our being? Our readings from Mark chapter 7, Jesus confronts this question head on. As he engages with the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, these religious leaders were meticulous in observing the traditions of their elders, believing that adherence to these external practices was the key to righteousness. Yet, Jesus, with divine authority, calls them to look beyond the external and focus on the heart, where true holiness resides. Let's talk about the danger of empty traditions. The Pharisees and some of the scribes noticed that Jesus' disciples ate with hands that were unclean, meaning they had not followed the ritual washing prescribed by the tradition. So they were quick to question Jesus about this apparent neglect of tradition. Of course, what the tradition says is good for personal hygiene, washing your hand as often as you can, especially these days, and try to wash anything that from outside to bring in home. It's all good. But Jesus responds with a powerful rebuke, quoting the prophet Isaiah, "These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules." Here, Jesus highlights the danger of empty traditions, religious practices that have lost their meaning and connection to the heart. Well, you know, one of the top reasons why the church is split is the color of the carpet in the sanctuary. Did you know that? Or we have our opinions about what to wear, how to do your hair, all these things when you come to church. And if children or baby makes noise, everybody turn around and look at that person, pressuring, "Hey, quiet your baby." I'd rather come to church with lots of noise made by children than all old folks like me in the pews. So it has been issues in the church for a while that what to do, the code of conduct, dress code, and all these things. By just look, one look you give to the newcomer that is good enough to repel them forever. Think about it. We have a couple of visitors today. Now we, as a believer, how to behave is quite a way to tell what kind of people we are. The Pharisees had elevated human tradition above God's commandments. So they were more concerned with the outward appearance of holiness than with its inward reality. Jesus exposes this hypocrisy and challenges us to examine our own practices. So, are we merely going through the motions, or are our actions an expression of a heart truly devoted to God? Secondly, I'd like to talk about true holiness comes from within. Jesus then turned to the crowd and makes a profound statement, saying, "Listen to me, everyone, and understand this. Nothing outside a person can defile them by going into them. Rather, it is what comes out of a person that defiles them." With this, Jesus shifts the focus from external rituals to the internal condition of our heart. The religious leaders believed that defilement came from external sources, like a food, object that we touch, or actions that we make. But Jesus teaches that true defilement comes from within ourselves, from the thoughts, attitudes, and desire that shapes our actions. The true holiness is not about avoiding external contamination. Rather, it's about cultivating a pure heart. It is about allowing the Spirit of God to transform us from the inside out, so that our words, thoughts, and deeds reflect God's holiness. Lastly, I want to talk about the source of defilement and the call to true holiness. Jesus goes on even further, listing the evil that comes from within. Listing the evils that comes from within. He says, "For it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come. Sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, debauchery, envy, slander, pride, folly. All these evil things come from within ourselves, and they defile us." So this list is not exhaustive, but it is a stark reminder of the corruption that can reside in the human heart. These are the things that truly define us. Not the failure to follow ritualistic tradition. Jesus' words are a call to deep introspection. He invites us to examine the state of our heart and to seek God's transformative power to cleanse and renew us. In other words, you may come to church in suit and tie and sit holy, but after you left the church, if you behave not accordingly, you're not holy. You may come to church saying all the nice words and greet each other, but once you leave here, you're stingy, you're judgmental, you're a hostile person to others. Don't call yourself Christian. So, true holiness is a matter of heart. It is not about strict adherence to rituals or traditions. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that rituals and traditions are not important. It is important, but that's not the end. But the important thing is about a heart that is aligned with God's will, purified by God's grace, and transformed by God's Spirit. Jesus calls us to move beyond the surface level of religious observance and to pursue a deeper, more authentic relationship with God. As we reflect on this passage, let us ask ourselves, are we more concerned with outward appearances or with the condition of our hearts? Are we seeking to live in true holiness, allowing God to cleanse us from within? May we heed Jesus' words and seek the kind of holiness that comes from a heart fully devoted to God. A holiness that is not just skin deep, but rooted in the very depth of our being. There is a story about a cracked pot. A water bearer in India had two large pots, each hung on the end of a pole that he carried across his neck. One of the pots had a crack in it, while the other was perfect and always delivered a full portion of water. So at the end of the long walk from the stream to the master's house, the cracked pot arrived only half full. This went on daily for 2 years. The perfect pot was proud of its accomplishment, but the cracked pot was ashamed of its imperfection. After 2 years of what it perceived to be a bitter failure, the cracked pot spoke to the water bearer, "I'm ashamed of myself, and I want to apologize to you." The water bearer asked, "Why are you ashamed?" The pot replied, "Because this crack in my side causes water to leak out all the way back to your master's house." The bearer smiled and said, "Did you notice that there are flowers only on your side of the path? I have always known about your flaw, so I planted flower seed on your side of the path. Every day as we walk back, you've been watering them. For 2 years, I have been able to pick these beautiful flowers to decorate the master's table. Without you being just the way you are, he would not have this beauty to grace his house." This story teaches that true holiness isn't about being perfect on the outside. It is about allowing God to use our imperfections for God's glory and to let God's love and grace flow through us, making even our flaws a source of beauty and blessing to others. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, purify our hearts, transform our minds, and make us holy as you are holy. Amen.
Amen.
And as we prepare tithe and offerings, shall we bow our heads and pray again. Gracious God, we bring these offerings with hearts full of love and gratitude, inspired by the beauty of your creation and the love that binds us. Just as the Song of Solomon celebrates love's arrival, we dedicate this gift to further your kingdom with joy and patience. May they bring hope, peace, and transformation, reflecting your love for all. Help us to be stewards of your grace and love in this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Jamina? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets.
And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Son Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on the gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory. And we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Children of God, let us pray. Our God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body. We all partake of the same loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. We, the United Methodist Church, practice open communion. So you're all welcome at the Lord's table, whether you're a member of this church or not, whether you're even baptized or not. Once you commit yourself to believe in Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're all welcome here at the Lord's table. You'll be seated, and ushers will guide you to the chancel area. Come in, usher, please come forward. He was hosting the special couple, the first surprise to you. Thank you. Have we fed everybody? If you have not received the communion, raise your hand. All right, shall we bow our heads and pray one more time? Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others, the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So it's announcement time, and I'd like to invite you all to the coffee hour, and special thanks to Emorua family for hosting coffee hour, and also all those of you who are here first time. If you want to talk with me and leave your contact, and I'm not going to bother you, but I may contact you. And also read the announcement section of the bulletin. There are a lot of schedules and updates in our schedule. Any other announcement needs to be made? All right, then shall you all stand if you're able for the closing hymn? As Christ has fed and redeemed your life, now go into the world in peace and love, offering ministries of hope and justice. Go in peace, and may the peace of God always be with you. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you.